You're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to repeat this for you again tonight. Tom Valentine has announced his retirement, and his broadcast will be going off the air. I don't know if he's still going to do something at another time or whatever. He's been broadcasting for a long time. And I had asked WWCR over the last 4 years repeatedly for an earlier time slot and was promised that the first earlier time slot that came open would be mine. And I also told them that if Tom Valentine ever decided to leave the air, I would like to have those 2 hours, Monday through Friday night, where he had been broadcasting. Well, it happened, ladies and gentlemen. They had assured me all of this time that that's the way it would be. And now they're telling me that the earlier audience cannot handle the Hour of the Time, which means the management of WWCR is spraying a whole bunch of bullshit, because that's exactly what it is. You see, it may be midnight Eastern time, but I'm on the air right now at 9 o'clock Pacific time. So does that mean that George McClintock is trying to tell me that on the West Coast the hour is okay at 9 p.m., but on the East Coast it's not okay at 10 p.m.? Is that the kind of bullshit that they're trying to put over on me and my audience? Or is this a blatant attempt to try to keep a larger audience from hearing the Hour of the Time? I don't know which it is, but I've given WWCR notice that if I don't get that time slot, that, like they've told me over the last 4 years, that I'm going to take this broadcast to another radio station or another network somewhere else. Because of 4 years of paying premium rates, premium broadcasting rates to WWCR, and garnering the largest shortwave radio audience, bar none, of any other shortwave radio broadcast that there is. I have the largest audience that there is, period. If that doesn't mean anything to WWCR, then WWCR means absolutely nothing to me. So if you want to help make this come about, and get the Hour of the Time in those 2 hours from 10 to midnight Eastern, 9 to 11 Central, 8 to 10 Mountain, and 7 to 9 Pacific, then you're going to have to write a lot of letters. And if you don't write a lot of letters, folks, listen to me. I never say anything unless I mean it. I'm already talking to other people. If this doesn't happen, I'm leaving WWCR. I've already given them notice. And I'll go to another station or another network, or I'll just broadcast on satellite, or I may not even broadcast at all, but I will not pay good money to a station that doesn't give a damn about my broadcast. So there you have it. Here's the address, WWCR 1300 WWCR Avenue. That's WWCR 1300 WWCR Avenue, Nashville, Tennessee 37218. You're going to have to write an awful lot of letters. Seems like the management of WWCR has cold feet. They're afraid of airing this broadcast at an earlier time slot. And you're going to have to exert your weight to let them know that that's what you want. And if that doesn't happen, you're not going to hear the Hour of the Time on WWCR anymore. They double-crossed me. They lied to me over and over and over again. And I happen to know that during those 4 years, they did have some earlier time slots available. and still would not let this broadcast go to an earlier time slot on this frequency or any other. And I've had it up to here with censorship and bullshit artists and lies. So write WWCR 1300 WWCR Avenue, Nashville, Tennessee, 37218. You might just make them mad enough that they'll drop me anyway, but just remember, I dropped them first. WWCR 1300 WWCR Avenue, Nashville, Tennessee, 37218. One more time, WWCR 1300 WWCR Avenue, Nashville, Tennessee, 37218. You better make it work, folks, or this broadcast is disappearing off WWCR just shortly after the end of this month. I gave them 30 days notice to either make it happen or I'm out of here. Bye-bye. Gone.
Of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Continue with part four, ladies and gentlemen, of our public notice. This public notice will be construed to comply with provisions necessary to establish presumed fact, Rule 301, Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, and attending state rules. Should interested parties fail to rebut any given allegation or fact or matter of law addressed during this public notice, the position will be construed as adequate to meet requirements of judicial notice, thus preserving fundamental law. Matters addressed during this public notice, if not rebutted, will be construed to have general application. The memorandum addresses jurisdiction of United States district courts and related agencies of the United States government. In Foley Brothers v. Filardo, 336 United States Supreme Court, 281, 1949, the High Court said it is a well-established principle of law that all federal legislation applies only within the territorial jurisdiction of the United States unless a contrary intent appears. In order for a contrary intent to be facilitated, delegations of authority and implementing regulations must be published in the Federal Register and or any given statute must clearly articulate application. Fortunately, ladies and gentlemen, there is a reasonable, easy way to discern what statutes in the United States Code have general application to the several states and the population at large. This is through the parallel table of authorities and rules, which begins on page 751 of the 1995 Index Volume to the Code of Federal Regulations. Its authority is located at 1 Code of Federal Regulations, section 8.5, small a. Parallel tables, which says, parallel tables of statutory authorities and rules. In the Code of Federal Regulations Index, or at some other place as the Director of the Federal Register considers appropriate, numerical lists of all sections of the current edition of the United States Code, except section 301 of Title V, which are cited by issuing agencies as rulemaking authority for currently effective regulations in the Code of Federal Regulations. The lists shall be arranged in the order of the titles and sections of the United States Code, with parallel citations to the pertinent titles and parts of the Code of Federal Regulations. This handy finding aid, folks, lists United States Code statutes by title and section in the left column. If implementing regulations have been published in the Federal Register, and applicable regulations by title and part in the right. If the statute doesn't appear, it doesn't have implementing regulations which have been published in the Federal Register, signifying that, in accordance with 44 United States Code Service, section 1505, small a, 1, provisions, the statute is applicable only to federal agencies or the officers, agents, and employees of federal agencies or the federal government. If the statute number does appear and a regulation is cited, the regulation must be consulted to determine application. Where the instant matter is concerned, the table immediately resolves the matter of territorial jurisdiction for United States District Courts. There are no implementing regulations for 18 United States Code Service, subsection 7 and 3231. The absence of implementing regulations for these two statutes confirms that United States District Court Special Maritime and Territorial Authority does not reach the several states and the population at large. The authority applies only on federal enclaves ceded to the United States for constitutional purposes, and as the second paragraph of section 3231 specifies, the laws and judicial authority of the several states are superior and govern within the states other than on federal enclaves ceded by legislatures of the states. Further, there are no implementing regulations for 28 United States Code Service, subsection 631 to 639, the Federal Magistrate Act, which is to say these glorified national park rangers in black robes, known as federal magistrate judges, have absolutely no authority in the several states. Therefore, the United States District Courts have no authority in the several states per the following. Quote, powers and duties were coextensive with limits of judicial district in which he was appointed. United States versus Hardin, 1881, D.C., North Carolina, 10 F. 802. United States versus Stern, 1910, D.C., Pennsylvania, 177 F. 479. End quote. Where matters pertaining to alleged offenses under the Internal Revenue Code are concerned, there are no implementing regulations to support 26 United States Code Service, section 7402, which prescribes jurisdiction for United States District Courts. This confirms proofs in the public notice memorandum, which demonstrate that there are no implementing regulations for Internal Revenue Code statutes prescribing taxing, assessment and collection authority, save as relates to import duties on distilled spirits, etc., itemized in subtitle E of the Internal Revenue Code, with the general authority being 27 Code of Federal Regulations Part 70, which is under the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms exclusive administration. Matters relating to United States securities, etc., are commonly at issue via federal prosecution, so it is useful, very useful, to briefly examine underlying authorities. The Constitution for the United States of America, at Article 1, Section 8.1, provides, quote, "The Congress shall have power to coin money and regulate the value thereof," end quote, and at Section 10.1 stipulates that, quote, "No state shall coin money, emit bills of credit, make anything but gold and silver coin, a tender in payment of debts," end quote. Now, since these provisions have never been amended or repealed, underlying authorities for current United States credit and monetary systems should be examined for application, and let's see if there are any. 12 United States Code Service, Section 226, the Federal Reserve Act. There is no regulation. 12 United States Code Service, Section 227, the Banking Act of 1933. There is no regulation. 12 United States Code Service, Section 228, Banking Act of 1935. There is no regulation. And when I kept telling you people that these are not the reason that we're in trouble, these are not the reason that this country is going down the tubes, you wrote me letters thinking that I was attacking Gene Schroeder for some reason. Nope, I was just telling you the truth. You see, none of these have any application in the several states at all, whatsoever. Gene Schroeder is a wonderful person, but he's on the wrong track. And I've said it over and over and over again. I like Gene Schroeder. He's a friend of mine. There are no regulations applicable to the several states for the Jury Selection and Service Act at 28 United States Code Service, subsection 1861, XSEC. Use of the parallel tables of authorities and rules is probably easiest to demonstrate by analysis of an actual case issued via the Department of Justice and or one of a United States attorney. In order to do this, I will use United States of America versus Kenny F. Moore, Colleen Moore, and Wayne Gunwall, 96 CR 082C, United States Court for the Northern District of Oklahoma, Tulsa, under stamped impressions of Neil Kirkpatrick, Assistant United States Attorney, and Fred White, Grand Jury Foreman. The same people were charged in 95 CR-129C in the fall of 1995 by the very same Assistant U.S. Attorneys, with Mr. White serving as Grand Jury Foreman, and the case was assigned to the same judge. However, the Grand Jury Foreman was presented with some of the same information included in this public notice, and subsequently the Moores and Mr. Gunwall filed criminal complaints against government principals, sending complaints and evidences to the U.S. District Court in care of the court clerk and to the Oklahoma Attorney General, W.A. Drew Edmondson. The complaint was received by the U.S. District Court clerk on Friday, November 17th. Then Assistant U.S. Attorney Kirkpatrick entered a motion to dismiss charges on Monday, November the 20th. Grand jury indictment against the Moores and Mr. Gunwall were allegedly issued again on May 15, 1996, with a summons in a criminal case, 96-CR-082-C, issued July 5, 1996, under the semblance of a signature for Phil Lombardi, allegedly the issuing officer of some undisclosed rank and horsepower. The case is interesting for a number of reasons and wouldn't be included in this public notice except that government insiders have chosen to scandalize the Moores and Mr. Gunwall via statewide Oklahoma media. The communist news networks are at it again. One of the crucial points is that after receiving summons for Dr. and Mrs. Moore, The government sent the Gunwale summons to the Moors and more papers to Gunwale. Mr. Gunwale drove from Ponca City to Tulsa and attempted to secure copies of relevant material from the office of the United States District Court Clerk, but the file was unavailable. Allegedly still at an old office that wasn't open that particular day. Yet the information was made available to Oklahoma print and broadcast media and principals from the United States government and the office of Oklahoma Attorney General Edmondson fueled media reporting with comments. Now, it would be difficult to inflict much more injury on the Moors and Mr. Gunwale than government officials have already choreographed. The question of the moment, however, concerns charges issued against Dr. and Mrs. Moore and Mr. Gunwale. What authority lies behind them? Government charges rest on four statutes, presented here in the order they appear on the face of the alleged grand jury indictment, 18 United States Code, Section 371, Conspiracy, 26 United States Code, Section 7212, small a, Interfering with Administration of Internal Revenue Laws, 18 United States Code, Section 1341, Mail Fraud, and 18 United States Code, Section 2, Aiding and Abetting. By consulting the parallel table of authorities and rules, supra, it is found that there are no implementing regulations extending general application authority to the several states and the population at large for any of these statutes. Therefore, the statutes are applicable only to agencies of the United States and officers, agents, and employees thereof, per 44 United States Code, Section 1505, small a, which I have cited previously. The only charge which might be of some concern would be mail fraud, as Congress is obligated under Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution with providing mail service for the several states. However, manipulation of postal service was one of the first congressional initiatives which, for all practical purposes, has moved the whole of the United States government under Congress's Article 4 legislative jurisdiction in the geographical United States. This was done via Act of Congress by the 37th Congress, Session 3, Chapter 71, 1863. Sections 22 and 23 of this Act distinguish between domestic mail in the geographical United States and drop mail elsewhere. Today, the United States Postal Service, a United States government corporation, handles domestic mail in the geographic United States, which is the District of Columbia, Puerto Rico, U.S. Virgin Islands, etc., etc., and non-domestic mail delivered in the several states and elsewhere. Regulatory application of 18 United States Code, Section 341, demonstrates the paradox in United States government. Even though Congress is charged under Article 1 of the Constitution with responsibility for maintaining mail service for the several states, alleged Article 4 authority to govern the geographical United States in any fashion not specifically prohibited by the Constitution confers absolutely no authority in and with respect to the several states party to the Constitution for the United States of America. Therefore, where Congress has elected to incorporate the United States Postal Service under Article 4 authority, statutes prescribing penalties for mail fraud, etc., are not applicable to or enforceable in the several states. Now, let me go into the summary and conclusions, and I hope that I can be able to finish that tonight. Through the 1930s, evolution of the corporate United States government under Congress's alleged Article 4 legislative jurisdiction in the geographical self-interested United States was referred to as corporatism. Presently, the United States Supreme Court and various other courts refer to the de facto arrangement between the United States and governments of the several states the latter operating under presumption that they are federal states rather than independent republics, subject only to Congress's Article I delegated authority as cooperative federalism. This diabolical scheme, from control of production and distribution of goods and services to the mathematically impossible social welfare system and criminal enforcement, is premised on the notion that all activity is commercial in nature. The effect has been to treat the nation as a seamless garment under Congress's Article IV legislative jurisdiction rather than a patchwork of 50 independent republics subject only to Congress's Article I delegated authority. Thankfully, ladies and gentlemen, very thankfully, in the last few years, the United States Supreme Court has provided footing which affords the possibility of correction. In New York versus United States, 1992, Supra, the High Court reiterated principles framed by the 10th Amendment and the separation of powers doctrine. So far as the several states are concerned, Congress can exercise only those powers specifically delegated by the Constitution, and officers of the several states cannot accommodate a United States power not delegated without first securing a constitutional amendment. Unrestricted application of the Commerce Clause has been taken to task in Lopez and other such cases. Unfortunately, judicially correcting the problem isn't as easy as it should be. Through the years, the United States Supreme Court has occasionally conveyed a message by way of decisions, or more appropriately, non-decisions. The maxim has been articulated when the court has been presented with evidences such as 14th and 16th Amendments not being properly ratified. Ratification of amendments is a political rather than a judicial matter. Now, if I read history properly, the nation's high court attempted to hold the line prior to acquiescence in Juilliard, 1884, and again resisted socialistic New Deal legislation until yielding in Erie Railroad, 1938. The choice in both cases appears to have been pragmatic. Yielding constitutional principles to the political tide.
Oh, God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside the night with the light from above. From the mountain to the prairie, through the ocean, white with foam, God bless America.
The time is brought to you by Swiss America Trading. They specialize in real money, hard assets, non-confiscatable, non-reportable hard assets. They're in Phoenix, folks, and they're just as close as your telephone. If you've never held a real silver dollar or a real $20 gold piece in your hand, I've got to tell you, you've got a real experience coming. You need to do it as soon as you can. Then you'll understand what the fuss is all about. This is a paper that they call a Federal Reserve note that has the numeral 1 on it. And then take another one out that has the numerals 20 for 20 on it. And then take another one out that has 100 written on it. And tell me the difference between them. You can't, because there isn't any. They're just pieces of paper with ink on them. They have no value whatsoever. They are not redeemable for anything, and their worth is only according to how many fools are willing to accept them. You see how you've been bamboozled? Call 1-800-289-2646. That's 1-800-289-2646. And get your hands on some real money. And folks, start a program to begin to accumulate real money on a regular basis so that when this whole phony house of bullshit cards comes tumbling down around our ears, you will not find yourself starving in a ditch in the rain. 1-800-289-2646. Call now. You know how you are. You're just like me. We all tend to procrastinate.
In the land of cotton, old times there are not forgotten. Look away, look away, look away, Dixieland. In Dixieland, where I was born.
The current pervasive circumstance, it is necessary to revisit first causes in order to address this terrible situation in which we find ourselves. As set forth in part one of this public notice, American founders proclaimed that the laws of nature and nature's God govern nations and men, and that all men are endowed with certain unalienable rights by their Creator. This foundation is acknowledged in preambles to state and national constitutions. The sovereign American people, by way of the constitutions, have granted certain enumerated powers. In New York versus United States et al., 1992, Supra, the United States Supreme Court addressed the matter of authority. In the American system, the question isn't what power governments should have, but what powers have been delegated. The court further concluded that public servants who usurp powers not delegated invariably do so for self-serving ends. The problem, of course, ladies and gentlemen, is accountability. As the development history presented in the Beecraft Memorandum demonstrates, the several states precede the United States. The original 13 colonies secured independence from English rule, and each thereby established sovereignty as an independent nation. The confederation they maintained following the Revolution was at best weak. Having precious little authority over the several new states. This arrangement threatened harmony and even survival of the Confederation. These difficulties spawned the Constitutional Convention in 1787, with the first states convening under the Constitution in 1789. The Constitution vested the United States authority necessary to carry out delegated responsibilities. However, the people and the several states did not surrender more than was delegated. They retained that which they did not delegate, including sovereignty over territories within the respective states. Thomas Jefferson, responding to alien and sedition acts, addressed this very problem, and the proper order of things in the American system of government in the Kentucky Resolutions. William Clinton, you have professed a great admiration for Thomas Jefferson. I suggest that you listen very carefully. Quote, 8th, resolved, that a committee of conference and correspondence be appointed, who shall have in charge to communicate the preceding resolutions to the legislatures of the several states, to assure them that this commonwealth continues in the same esteem of their friendship and union which it has manifested from the moment at which a common danger first suggested a common union, that it considers union for specified national purposes, and particularly to those specified in their late federal compact, to be friendly to the peace, happiness, and prosperity of all the states, that faithful to that compact, according to the plain intent and meaning in which it was understood and acceded to by the several parties, it is sincerely anxious for its preservation, that it does also believe that to take from the states all the powers of self-government and transfer them to a general and consolidated government without regard to the special delegations and reservations solemnly agreed to in that compact is not for the peace, happiness, and prosperity of these states, and that therefore this commonwealth is determined, as it doubts not its co-states are, to submit to undelegated and consequently unlimited powers in no man or body of men on earth. That in cases of an abuse of the delegated powers, the members of the general government, being chosen by the people, a change by the people would be the constitutional remedy. But where powers are assumed which have not been delegated, a nullification of the act is the rightful remedy. That every state has a natural right, in cases not within the compact, to nullify of their own authority all assumptions of power by others within their limits. That without this right, they would be under the domination, absolute and unlimited, of whosoever might exercise this right of judgment for them. That nevertheless this commonwealth, from motives of regard and respect for its co-states, has wished to communicate with them on the subject, that with them alone it is proper to communicate, they alone being parties to the compact, and solely authorized to judge in the last resort of the powers exercised under it. Congress being not a party, but merely the creature of the compact, and subject as to its assumptions of power to the final judgment of those by whom and for whose use itself and its powers were all created and modified, that if the acts before specified should stand, these conclusions would flow from them, that the general government may place any act they think proper on the list of crimes and punish it themselves, whether enumerated or not enumerated by the Constitution as cognizable by them, that they may transfer its cognizance to the president or any other person who may himself be the accuser, counsel, judge, and jury, whose suspicions may be the evidence, his order the sentence, his officer the executioner, and his breast the sole record of the transaction. That a very numerous and valuable description of the inhabitants of these states being, by this precedent, reduced as outlaws to the absolute dominion of one man, and the barrier of the Constitution thus swept away from us all, no rampart now remains against the passions and the powers of a majority in Congress to protect from a like exportation or other more grievous punishment. The minority of the same body, the legislatures, judges, governors, and counselors of the states, nor their other peaceable inhabitants, who may venture to reclaim the constitutional rights and liberties of the states and of the people, or who, for other causes, good or bad, may be obnoxious to the views, are marked by the suspicions of the president, or be thought dangerous to his or their election or other interests, public are personal. End quote. Jefferson's argument, ladies and gentlemen, is as valid in 1996 as it was in 1798. Congress and the other branches of federal government are not party to the Constitution. They are products of it. The Constitution vests Congress with certain delegated authorities under Article 1 and nothing more. Within its own borders, state authority is antecedent to that of the United States, and as parties to the Constitution, the several states have both the right and responsibility to correct their agent, the United States, when ambition seeks to abuse or expand powers which have been delegated. What is the instrument of that correction? Why, ladies and gentlemen, it is the militia. Of more immediate importance, where the instant matter is concerned, those who exceed the law, whether of the state or the United States, are accountable to the law of the land, and ultimately to the people of the land within the several states. Operation of under color of law is outlaw, criminal, and accountability must be in law. Judges, magistrates, attorneys for the Department of Justice, and enforcement people do not have immunity when they exceed the law as it is written. This public notice conclusively demonstrates jurisdiction of United States district courts in the several states. Implicitly, authority of the Department of Justice and United States enforcement agencies attached to the department is concurrent with that of United States courts, as the lawful authority of any given agency extends only so far as the legislative jurisdiction of the government it serves. All legislation, ladies and gentlemen, is territorial in nature. Under penalties of perjury, per 28 United States Code, section 1746, 1, I attest that to the best of my current knowledge and understanding, all matters of law and facts set out in this public notice are accurate and true. Signed, July 19, 1996, Dan Meador. Signed, July 25th, 1996, William Cooper. And that concludes our public notice, ladies and gentlemen. I will now, because I am sleepy and I am tired of talking and my throat is terribly irritated, open the phones. But you can call that 1-800-289-2646. 520-333-4578 is the number. Good evening. You're on the air. Hello? Hello?
I appreciate your show, and I thank you for it very much. In regards to what you were mentioning about WWCR and the way they've been treating you?
Yes.
They have a couple of programs that are satanic in nature. One's called The Coming of Antichrist. One's called Tempered Steel. And they're both in prime time on a Sunday afternoon.
But you see, I can't entertain what you're saying because I believe in the freedom of speech.
Okay. Well, when they say you're too controversial, these programs are kind of a hypocrisy of what their station stands for.
Well, now you're making a valid point.
Right. And I was kind of stunned that these kind of programs are on, but like I said, for what they stand for. So I want to also give a phone number for WWCR. It's to the station manager. It's area code 615 255-1300. And you can address...
Can you say that number again, please?
It's area code 615-255-1300.
Is that 255?
Yes.
615-255-1300.
Yes, and that'll get you directly to the station manager. And the third thing I'd like to ask is, how is Gary Bourgeois doing?
Oh, you know, I'm glad you brought that up, because I wanted to thank everyone out there who sent cards and letters to Gary. He's doing much better. He feels much better. He's still not well. But I got to tell you, you sure brightened up his world. And Gary's never had that happen to him before. And he was just beside himself with happiness. So all of you who sent him cards and letters, I thank you from the bottom of my heart. Gary thanks you from the bottom of his. Although he didn't want me to do it, I know that he was very happy to get all your cards and letters.
Okay, Bill, that's all I wanted to call you about.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good night.
520-333-4578 is the number. Good evening. You're on the air.
Oh, yes. Good evening, Bill. This is Virginia over here in Texas.
Hi.
I just wanted to ask you how the day one book is coming. Is it going to be out soon?
Should be out in September. It's at the printer now.
Okay.
All the editing, all typesetting, everything is done. It is at the printer. It's just a question of getting... we're waiting for the blue lines to come back, and that'll be the final go-over to make sure there's no glaring mistakes sticking out. And then they'll print the book and bind it and ship it to us, and then we'll ship it out to you.
Okay, I'm anxiously waiting. I want to ask you about, have you heard about this Executive Order 13010, July the 15th, I believe it was, where the power of the presidency, he is giving it over to the military Department of Defense?
No, I have not seen that. People have told me about it, but I haven't seen it. Does anybody have a copy of it, or is this another one of those rumors?
Well, it's supposed to be an executive order. I just heard about
it. No. Does anybody have a copy of it, or is it just one of those rumors?
I don't know who would have a copy, but it's...
Have you seen a copy?
No, sir. I just heard about it.
Have you seen anybody who has a copy?
No.
Then why are you passing around a rumor?
Well, I was asking a question if you had seen anything of that.
No.
Okay, well, thank you, Bill.
You're welcome. Folks, don't pass around rumors. Nothing is fact until you can prove it. Don't forget that. Good evening. You're on the air.
Yes, Bill.
Yes.
I just wanted to ask you if you decide not to go with WWCR to please continue broadcasting on shortwave some way, somehow, because... there are a lot of people listening that can't hear you any other way, and a lot of us out here really appreciate what you're doing.
Oh, I will certainly try to do that. I can't promise that. I may go to a clear channel station like KOA out of Denver or something. I don't know, but I'm talking to various people. I'm talking to a network. I'm talking to other stations. So it looks like there'll be no problem with continuing broadcasting. It's just a question of what medium I choose to do it in.
One other thing. Do you still have an email address that people can write to you with?
Yeah, I do, but I'm not going to give it out over the air. Last time I did that, it took me 6 months to clear my mailbox, and I don't have the time to be messing around with that. And most of the messages were absolutely of no consequence whatsoever, just a waste of time.
Okay, thanks for your time.
You're welcome.
Bye.
And I don't mean that to sound bad to you folks. I mean, a lot of you just sent me an email message, say hi, la 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 la. I just don't have time for it. I do not have time for it. I'm sorry. That's the way it is. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hi, Bill. Tom from Indiana.
Yes.
I had a question for you. Occasionally, from time to time, in between when you're playing the music, there's this one song that has the words in it, something in the effect of everybody knows. Who is the artist, and what's the name of that album or tape?
That's from a movie about a kid who does an outlaw radio broadcast in his town.
Huh.
I think it's Pump Up the Volume is the name of it.
Is that the name of the, just the name of the album?
It's the name of the movie and the name of the album.
Okay. Who does the singing on that? Is that somebody?
I don't know. Leonard Cohen also does a version of that, too.
Okay. But you're playing the movie version of it, then?
I play both.
Oh, okay. Leonard Cohen.
Yeah.
And is there another song on that you play, too? Because it sounds like very similar style.
Stand. It's called Stand. It's the only other one I play off that album.
Stand?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, great. Well, that's all I wanted to know.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Bye-bye.
By the way, somebody sent me a tape in the mail and a couple of dollars and wanted me to make them a copy of one of the things that I play. I don't do that, folks. I don't have time for it. The only things that we can give you are what's in our catalog, period. Good evening. You're on the air.
Oh, good evening, and I'm amazed I got through. It's a pleasure to talk to you, sir. Just one quick question. How can I order copies, studio copies, of the entire statement that you made tonight?
Just send $10 if you're not a member. Let me specify this, make it clear. If you're not a member of CAGI or the Intelligence Service, tapes, studio broadcast quality stereo tapes of the hour of the time are available. They're $10 per tape. You must specify the date and the subject or use the number from our catalog. So if you want all four of these tapes, then you would specify all four of the dates. The date is always before midnight if you're on the East Coast. And specify the subject, which would be public notice.
Okay. Thanks a lot.
You're welcome.
If you got a second, I got to tell you, a strange thing happened in Chicago a couple of weeks ago.
On your way to the forum?
Yeah. In fact, one of our major metalhead disc jockeys out here claimed to have been contacted by some covert type, ex-CIA or something like that. And got the whole skinny on the New World Order. And he came into work one day and freaked out the entire city of Chicago with it. And your name came up several times during the show.
Yeah.
People wanted to know about your book. Other people wanted to tell them how to get it. I made sure I got the name of the book out for you. Mm-hmm. And I just wanted to tell you that Chicago got a wake-up call that kind of amazed everybody.
Well, good. That's wonderful.
Yeah, and you were part of it. So, anyway, it's a pleasure. I'll get off so somebody else can get on.
Thank you for calling.
Thank you.
520-333-4578. Good evening. You're on the air.
Bill Cooper, Howard from Pennsylvania.
Hello, Howard.
How are you?
Is this Howard B?
Yes, it is.
Well, long time no hear. How are you?
Much too long. I have good information I'd like to get on the air.
What's it concern?
Concerns the...
Wait a minute, we just lost the satellite. Hold on, let me get back on.
Let me know when you're back on. It's the second time tonight.
Yep. Okay. Now we're back on, Howard. That's the second time tonight we lost the satellite, folks, in case you didn't notice. And we're the only show that this happens to. So go ahead, Howard. What's this about now?
You're also the only show that seems to get jammed repeatedly, especially out here on the East Coast.
Well, the East Coast is the bastion home of socialism. They don't want their little socialist children to hear the truth.
But don't forget that I call you from the cradle of liberty, and there is still liberty left in this portion of the East Coast.
That's true.
However, maybe not for long. Pennsylvania has been trying to push through a bill, number one, to gut the search and seizure aspect of our Constitution and make it exactly the same as the federal Constitution, and then also say that whatever the Supreme Court decides, that's okay with us, our Constitution will mirror that. Coupling that, they're also trying to push through legislation that will give any federal officer with a badge and a gun police powers within the state, I shouldn't call it the state of Pennsylvania, within the Pennsylvania Commonwealth. Now, if your states have not already done this, you ought to be looking at your legislatures and finding out whether they've got bills like this on the table. Because when they do it here, they're doing it elsewhere. And I have found that what they will do is they will wait and bring up some kind of welfare legislation, get everybody screaming and yelling about that, and then quietly slip these things through on floor votes.
Yeah, they're trying to pass that same law in many states all across the country. Not every state yet, but many states. But I have to tell you that states cannot make laws that contradict the Constitution. And the Constitution strictly limits the powers granted to the federal government. So even if they do pass the laws, they're unconstitutional. But if they ignore it and kill people who resist it, it's just like these common law people who pass judgment on somebody and can't arrest them, you know.
But not only are they unconstitutional, but what Pennsylvania does is Pennsylvania has a provision in the Constitution in the Article 1, which is the Declaration of Rights, that says you cannot, government, change anything in this section. We don't trust you.
Yeah.
We forever make it inviolate.
Uh-huh.
So they get around that by saying, okay, the people can vote on it. They put it on the ballot, and then they word the ballot question in such a way that the people vote for it, and then later say, oops, I didn't understand what I was voting for.
Well, even then, it's unconstitutional, because doesn't it have to be an amendment to your Constitution?
Well, that's exactly what the people vote on.
Oh, you're saying that they're voting on amendments.
Yes, they vote on an amendment to the Constitution, and they say because the people are doing it, not the government, and I thought the people were the government, that it's constitutional. But what they do is they deceive the people.
Well, it's not constitutional if the Constitution says that section can never be changed. The people, nobody can change it.
Well, the problem is that they have all these Supreme Court decisions in Pennsylvania that they refer to. And I believe it's unconstitutional, but what I believe and what the legislature believes is usually two different things. But my message to the people listening out there is look at your legislatures and find out what bills they've got on tap and what they're trying to push through it, because while everybody screams about welfare and abortion and everything else, they're quietly gutting the constitutions of this country.
That's correct. You're absolutely right, Howard.
And they're doing it with impunity. And that's the problem. And they also make it very difficult. Pennsylvania just got a cable network that actually shows what they do on television, but it doesn't show them when they're doing things like this, because they also have control over the content of what goes on these cable broadcasts.
Yes.
Just as the House of Representatives has control in Washington of what you get to see because they run the cameras.
Yeah. Also, there's a bill in front of the House of Representatives in Washington, D.C., right now, which concerns the threat to the security of the United States from the militias. It is a confidential bill. CON does not mean conference, it means confidential. And there is no information available on it anywhere.
It also seems to be the ticket du jour for our Attorney General nominee on the Democratic side. They seem to be now picking up on the militia issue.
Yeah.
And I think they're going to hawk that as far as they can take it.
Well, just remember, I told you there's going to come a day when they're going to come after us. And when they do that, the war's going to start. We're out of time, Howard. Thanks for calling.
You're welcome.
Good night, folks, and God bless each and every single one of you.
Mind I the dream, the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is champing out the vintage where the great wrath has soared. He has loosed the fateful lightning of his camel's swift sword. His truth is marching on. I have seen him in the watchfires of 100 circling camps. They have built him an altar in the evening dews and dips. I have read his righteous sentence by the dim and faring lamp. His day is marching on. feel that my contemptors flow with you, my grace shall heal. Let the hero born of woman crush the serpent with his heel, since my God is marching.